Welcome to the Online Marketing Institute. You're now watching a free preview of an OMI e-learning center class.
We'll do some level setting on the advantages that mobile apps can bring over mobile websites, and we'll do a review of the types of apps by the business benefits that they create. A lot of the magic of mobile is locked up in apps. That mobile browsing has increased, and you can see the red line going up from 64 to 70.
What's interesting on this chart, for those of you who are marketers watching this Online Marketing Institute presentation, is that one of the big differences between the successful apps and those that are not as successful is the presence of a marketing budget and the presence of time being devoted from the development team and the business team to promoting the application. So marketing doesn't make apps, but it makes them successful from the start. Think about products, not projects. Learn from the marketplace. Become a student. Use this as a chance to shift your business. Maybe you can leave some limits behind. Maybe you can take on some new business models or gain or enter new markets in ways that would have been restricted in other technologies.
Hey everyone, it's Dave Winicky, still in Boston, and so ready to bring you in on the third and final part of Online Marketing Institute's Mobile Marketing Crash Course. As promised, this is the deep dive on making mobile native applications and what your role is as a marketing leader in their success. So, here's where we're going today. We'll do some level setting on the advantages that mobile apps can bring over mobile websites, and we'll do a review of the types of apps by the business benefits that they create. Then we're going to do an extra reality check on what it takes to make a winning app in the competitive landscape in the app mobile ecosystem. Like in earlier presentations, we're going to reconnect back to marketing and what marketing's role is in application success. Finally, we're going to get very real by looking at a range of apps and their reported development budgets. Now, this is what people at conferences I present at always want to know more about, and I think this will give you a great and probably otherwise unavailable view of the cost physics involved in taking on the kinds of mobile opportunities that we've discussed. Let's get going. Let's start out defining some terms. Answering what mobile is, in fact, can be tough. Sure, mobiles, tablets, and smartphones, but what about in the dashboard of a car? Well, that's mobile, but there's a different set of resources in that environment. What about in a game? It's definitely non-PC, but a lot of game consoles really don't move around that much, though some do. So for now, I tend to default to a broad, it's not a PC definition. If that's what mobile is, what's a native app? Most everything we experience online is driven by applications. You can take a look at some of these very well-known apps that are on the screen here, and I think we'll agree that an application experience is delivered through most well-known HTML sites. There's no doubt that the application experience owns the web. So why make separate apps that are compiled in operating system-specific code and separately installed on devices and that run on your device instead of a server? In short, why native apps? Well, they're used differently. They provide different marketing experiences, and they have different tactical advantages that can make them better for some uses. So let's go ahead and dive in and see what it is that sets apps apart. A lot of the magic of mobile is locked up in apps. This chart shows data from Comscore, Alexa, and Flurry Analytics, and it looks at the amount of time that customers spend on the web versus using mobile apps. And what's interesting is that mobile browsing has increased, and you can see the red line going up from 64 to 72, but the gray bar, which is mobile app usage, has skyrocketed faster, and it's now become larger than mobile browsing. So without addressing the advantages to consumers which cause this, to us as marketers, this inventory of engagement alone is a bona fide opportunity. Another dramatic finding from the same data is that the engagement time on apps is 4 times longer than the engagement time in browsing mobile websites. So there's a significant difference in how people use an app versus how they use a website on a mobile device. And these differences are valuable to know about, but now we can dig in and we can take a look at how apps get used differently and why they're so valuable to marketers. So there's a set of very valuable applications that I call relationship pipelines. They provide more immersive product-like experiences that connect companies to their customers in new ways. So you see the image here on the left? Car manufacturers rarely have direct relationships with consumers. That's why there's a whole dealer network that connects them to consumers. Hyundai included an iPad in each of its high-end Equus vehicles, and it made what I would call a relationship pipeline that directly connected them to their consumers. It had the car manual on it, but the car manual came with a way to schedule appointments, to give the factory feedback, for the car maker to push messages to the consumer, including, hey, it's time to think about buying the new model. It became a relationship pipeline that Hyundai wouldn't have otherwise had. Another good example of this kind of relationship pipeline is Columbia's GPS Pal. And GPS Pal is a mapping and journaling app that lets you track your adventures, collect your notes, photos, statistics as you go on adventures and hike or paddle, and then to share them out on social networks or to keep them as your own log. So by doing this, Columbia gets to be part of its customers' travels in a different way, and it facilitates conversations between them. And it also puts them in a position where they're aggregating content, which is extremely valuable to their audiences, and that they can make new use of that. So in both cases, these are brand relationships that wouldn't have been possible between manufacturers and customers, except for this relationship pipeline, which is the mobile app. Premium pipelines can change business models too. Expensify is an amazing free travel and expense management system. And you can see on their logo, it says expense reports that don't suck. That's their value proposition. But beyond that, it's a product that's really fun to use. What's interesting is they've used a freemium model to make this free and available to a huge installed base of individual users. And that both positions Expensify to know just a ton about travel purchasing and what people do as they move on business travel. And then it lets them provide a system which employees really like to use that integrates well with corporate employers' expensing systems. So the way this gets paid for, in fact, is by a secondary audience, not by the individual users, but by corporate users who want something that's terrific and already broadly adopted. It's a case where instead of advertising, they made a beautiful free service that was supported by an app, and they've become a real insurgent in the business travel expense reporting area. So the same is true of Pandora. Over here on the right, Pandora is changing music through an immense aggregated audience that uses its mostly free product. So this isn't a case of a business just grabbing hold of an app and moving a book to an app book. It really is using this freemium business model that the whole digital channel enables to do exciting new things to gain huge audiences and change businesses. As great as those examples are, though, I'd submit to you that the still unrealized killer app for mobile is e-commerce, because it puts the buy button anywhere. So as kind of a funny illustration, I'd like to show you the way people in Boston pay for parking when they ride the commuter rail to work. It's this metal box with numbers on it, and you need to cram $3 worth of bills, or 12 quarters, into a numbered slot that matches where your car is parked. Maybe you can see on the right-hand side of the picture there's a little metal wire that comes down. Well, there's a piece of metal on the end of that, because in order to optimize the commerce experience, you can use this piece of metal to cram your dollar bills in and to pack the quarters in with the dollar bills so they don't come popping back out. I can only imagine the fun of unpacking this individually. It's really a pretty brutal system. But now, because of a mobile app called Park Mobile, I can pull up the app while I'm waiting for the train, put in my space number, and have my credit card automatically charged. The purchase is definitely smoother than going to visit a website. It leverages GPS to pre-populate fields. And while a website could do this, it couldn't do this as well. And anyone who's made their living in e-commerce knows that ease is key. So iJukebox is another kind of interesting example. It lets you pay with your credit card to play music at stores or restaurants or other places where you may go. Merchants get new revenue. Customers get to pick the tunes that they're hearing. Music rights holders get paid. And it all happens without a big real jukebox standing around. So again, the buy button in this case is for a virtual product that plays music around you. But maybe a more mainstream use is Starbucks. Starbucks has cleared over $40 million in payments through their in-store e-commerce solutions. And now stores like Target, Walmart, and two dozen other retailers are working on their own system for unified mobile payments. So these stores want people to show up with mobile devices with buy buttons on them, and they'll facilitate their own commerce in-store. So these examples so far show just how cross-departmental mobile development can be. None of these examples that we've looked at have been marketing-centric. Instead, they focused on expanding customer relationships, growing company reach, increasing profitability, all things that are kind of company-wide goals rather than a departmental goal. This creates an unusual opportunity for marketers who are maybe used to being messengers, because in the mobile app space, it's more like being a tool maker. And a great example of this is the Boston Globe real estate app. You can probably tell I'm sweet on the Globe. This is a tool set for home hunters. GPS shows them what nearby them is for sale, so if they pop up out of a subway, it's like having a tricorder for finding properties. And it connects them to useful data about neighborhoods, and then lets them save photos and notes from the properties that they've visited. And it blows out just a whole new advertising opportunity to take what the print advertisers would be doing in the print Globe and put it into the hands of people who are considering huge purchases right in the moments of decision. In fact, those people who are making that decision obviously are going to make dozens of other purchases that go along with buying a home, so it becomes a prime advertising opportunity. So I'm not just sweet on the Boston Globe. The New York Times has an app, which I love also. And what it's done is it's repositioned the Gray Lady as a way for people learning English in New York to do so while enjoying them as a news source. What's interesting is this positions them to go after this whole new demographic that maybe the daily news or language-specific newspapers would be filling, but it lets them do that without creating a whole new specialty publication and launching some kind of sub-brand which is niched by language or by ethnic group, and instead it creates a tool that's multilingual and uses their existing content base. So again, it's a way of shifting the product without having to create a whole new one to get into a new market. Both LogMeIn and Autodesk provide low-cost apps that, in my opinion, are just fantastic. And this is probably the first example of anything that people pay for. All the other things that we've seen facilitate commerce and brand relationship without a payment. But in the case of Autodesk and LogMeIn, they're delivering services that are compelling and economic and fun to use, and they're winning in the paid model. So in the case of LogMeIn, for what seems to be a trial period that goes on forever, I'm able to use my tablet to log on to either my work computer or my home computer while I'm riding the subway or train, and I'm able to do remote sessions on that. And what it's teaching me is how useful that is and how easy it would be to pay just a little bit more and get those sessions in high definition or get the security updates done on an automated basis. And earlier in these presentations, I talked about Autodesk and the amazing success they had in taking what's a multi-$1,000 product and making a little thin version of it for mainline consumers to do some simple drafting and simple design, and how it's made them relevant to whole new audiences while building their skill set. So mobile apps present a huge opportunity to digitize what would otherwise be expensive analog services, and to reach for accelerants like the free or the near free price point, which can drive dramatic new marketing acquisition. So all of the apps that we've talked about did something new with the mobile medium. What they didn't do was take their already existing website, book, or game and just poured it over from one medium into the mobile medium. Instead, they used mobile and the things that mobile is good at to adapt their business and do new things. Remember when BlackBerry and Palm Pilot's big claim was that you can run Excel on our teeny tiny mobile device? Well, it turned out that that wasn't the most compelling use case. If you think back, would you rather have been the company that figured out how to port Excel over into tiny mobile devices, or been the one that figured out that you could change the radio industry by launching Pandora? Transformative use really changes the playing field and does more for companies than porting a victory on an old platform onto a new platform, unless there's really a compelling use case for that. So we've looked at the strategic advantages of freemium and relationship pipelines, but there also are some tactical application advantages that are just based on the technology. Browsers are still a bit cut off from the mobile experience. Mobile apps have much better visibility to location. You can access some of the special powers of mobile devices, like the GPS or like things that measure them moving through space. Applications like GPS Pal do some pretty sophisticated caching for both online and offline performance, where if you're having a mobile web session, if you can't get to the mobile website, usually that session is broken and you're out of business. And mobile apps provide this really clean border for paywalls. And while it's possible to log in through websites and authenticate, authentication can be easier and you can build in more measurement. So a lot of the magic of mobile is still locked up in apps.
All right, so we talked about some examples of well-known brands and people who do a great job. And this is the reality check that I promised. Because there's a reason for wanting to be original and wanting to do something that stands out, and that is that the app marketplace is a really competitive place. There's a great piece of research that I want you to keep in mind if you're thinking about making an app, and that is that the top 50 apps that are already out there and very well established, whose names many of them you already know, take up 61% of app use time. That doesn't mean that there isn't a place to penetrate, but what it means is that consumers have 39% of their time available for something that's not already in the top 50. So while there's definitely space to get into the game, you have to be aware that it's a crowded marketplace and there's a lot of quality already at work. So there's a pattern that we see on the internet pretty often. It's the long tail pattern, where there's an 80 and a 20, or a 90 and a 10. And in the case of mobile app development, there's definitely a long tail. And the way it works is there's a long tail of mobile apps that don't succeed financially. Now, they may meet other business goals, but only 12% of developers of apps have cleared over $50,000, and only 11% of apps ever break 500,000 downloads. So there's a very long tail of non-performance or failure, and there's a relatively compact area of very successful apps. What's interesting on this chart, for those of you who are marketers watching this Online Marketing Institute presentation, is that one of the big differences between the successful apps and those that are not as successful is the presence of a marketing budget. And the presence of time being devoted from the development team and the business team to promoting the application. So not only does not everyone succeed, but there's a break line, and that break line has a marketers far more on this side of the applications that succeed than those who put a simply developed app out the door and hope that it gets found. This is indeed a competitive marketplace with over 900 new apps launching every day on Apple's App Store. And similar competition going on inside of Google's application store. You have to not only be a great app, but you have to be findable. And that's the task that marketers are great at and can make a huge contribution to. The app ecosystem lives inside of a bizarre love triangle. Unlike websites where you put a website up, people find you, maybe there's some Google involved, maybe people pass the links around. Everyone who uses your app will pass through an app store. And that's this aggregated market, either by Apple or Google or BlackBerry or someone with an OS. Without the ability to be seen in the app store or to be present in the app store, it's impossible to have a successful app. You as a marketer both need to be able to negotiate between your audience's demands and what developers create, and you also have to be able to make what the developers create be visible back to the audience the way you need it to be through the App Store. And we'll dive in and look at what some of the responsibilities, particularly for marketers, are. But this kind of success, I'm looking at Columbia's GPS Pal app, launched recently, and in its first week, it was in the top 15 of utilities. And that drove visibility for it, and that visibility drove more downloads, and there was a virtuous spiral of success. And part of that comes, again, from development, but we'll look at what some of the things that you as a marketer can do to help line that success up. So I want to talk with you just for a minute about the three key players that bring the application together. Obviously, there's a developer who's in charge of engineering the data and the user experience to be brought to life through functionalities. Before that, though, there's a designer who defines the user flows, the user experience, and the visual design of the application, and they bring a great deal of the identity and personality into the application. But kind of wrapped around those two, framing the enterprise, is a marketing and product manager. And they really drive the app from definition through adoption. And the process is sort of a marketing crescendo. And it begins at the very beginning of definition, looking at competitive factors, studying the App Store, understanding the marketing opportunity, and then doing things like orchestrating partnerships. So as the application's being developed, the way it's going to be distributed is in place. And then at launch time, making sure that the application has App Store visibility, as well as doing things going forward, like building the case for ongoing improvement, all fall to this marketing product manager kind of role. Now, as frustrating as the App Store may be, there's a great deal that you can learn from the market by becoming a student of the App Store. Things to watch are things like featured apps. You can see what's hot here and start deconstructing what some of the techniques are and what some of the markets are that people are penetrating. You can see over on the right-hand side, third down, there's Columbia's GPS app, and you can go and look at each of those and not only see what they do, but you can study their feedback. It's a fantastic opportunity to study competitors' feedback because you can hear the market that's available. You can see ideas. You can see firsthand what it is that works and not. And you can cut through, you know, kind of some of the haze of war by being able to hear the voice in these marketplaces. It's a great opportunity. And you as a marketer, if you've got an application that's going to be developed, need to be in there listening and learning from your market. Because mobile users are doing something else often when they're using their devices, because the devices themselves are small, the constraints mean that your product has to have great clarity. And one of the best things that you can do as a marketing professional is to help get your app so it's clearly understood by the market. And that means giving it a really powerful verbal hammer, picking the right 3 to 5 words that explain what it means to the market, and then creating an icon that goes along with it. You as a marketer contribute the verbal hammer and the visual nail that gives your product identity. So here are a number of the applications that we've looked at. And it goes from Expensify, expense reports that don't suck, to Columbia, GPS-enabled journaling for adventures, to Park Mobile, parking made simple. Getting it down so it's clear and compelling, with probably clarity in the lead, is one of the best things that you can do to help your app cut through the clutter of the App Store. And as mapping out user flows and designs and development goes on, you as the marketer and product manager need to keep the strategic vision of what you're trying to get done in the market alive. This is your chance to redefine your business. And if you just pored over old conventions, the old rules and limits come too. This is probably for another presentation, but companies that change the rules get a premium over those that are competing just on price or just on product. And this is a huge opportunity to shift the ground that your company is on, forge new relationships, and have a new customer experience through this new channel. Okay, we've made it to the last part. This is the secret sauce. I should note that the data behind these estimates is from published reports. None of it, to my knowledge, is privileged. I want to talk with you a little bit about the cost physics behind putting an app together. So let's start with a really well-known app. Instagram said that it took 20 person months to launch their application. Now, surely there was care and feeding afterwards, but if you were trying to frame up what was their initial investment, that's about $500,000 of initial build budget. The result of that, as you know, was over a $1 billion sale. Obviously, there was marketing, there was risk, there were many other things that happened, including the involvement of tons and tons of users. But if you were building an Instagram and you wanted some budget guidance, it's about $500,000 coming down from that. MasterCard's Priceless Pix is a GPS-enabled map that lets you share your location and get recommendations from around you. 12-person months of development, so that approximate budget is about $320,000. It's a sophisticated, big-brand, well-polished application, and you can see how that's an order of magnitude down from the production that went into Instagram, but still a very significant capital-level kind of investment. Who would know that Angry Birds actually was likely a lower investment than MasterCard's Priceless Pix? In its last investment round in 2011, Angry Birds maker Rovio had a $1.2 billion valuation. Their initial build budget was approximately $250,000. About half that price is a top 25 app called Flick Fishing, and it uses an accelerometer and 3D graphics and motion to simulate fishing. That took about 5-person months to create with an approximate budget of $130,000. Gap used web services to roll out a social networking-based in-store kind of e-tail retail application with about 3-person months of development or an $80,000 contribution. So you can see that this is thinner, it's being driven by data that's coming from other sources, it picks up a lot of the work already done likely for their website. For under $100,000, the Gap put out a nice branded application. So there's some great examples of value to look at, and I think the top one on my list would be Labyrinth, which is a Hall of Fame app. It's loaded on many iPads. If you have an iPad, you've probably tried this game out. It's had 10 million downloads, and Illusion Labs made it with just 2-person months of effort, or about a $50,000 initial build budget. You can do things that are extremely focused on a reasonable budget and get some amazing results. And then, you know, maybe even below that, a smaller application like Zip Finder, which is a highly data-driven GPS-enabled zip code locator. So you can go anywhere in New York and stand somewhere and know what zip code you're in. That brought data and usability together with about 1-person month of engineering, or $25,000. So there we are. Let's wrap up with a couple thoughts. And I think the first one is that marketing can't outsource application success. It really has to be based on a partnership, and it really has to be framed by strategic marketing thinking and then tactical marketing execution to win at the application store. So marketing doesn't make apps, but it makes them successful from the start. Think about products, not projects. Learn from the marketplace. Become a student. Use this as a chance to shift your business. Maybe you can leave some limits behind. Maybe you can take on some new business models or gain or enter new markets in ways that would have been restricted in other technologies. Get your strategy and your flow map set before wireframing or starting design. Get your wireframing and design done before you start development. Don't just think about the minimally viable product. Also think about the minimally viable personality. If you're going to invest your brand in this and invest your development budget in this, do something that really makes an impact. Do something that in fact is remarkable, and the market will connect with you better because of that. Finally, be ready to compete, to fail, learn, change, and live through your own success cycle. May fate give you everything you seek, and may you endure the success and change that you seek like a hero. So congratulations. That's the third installment to building your own mobile future. Thanks for going the distance with us, and always feel free to tweet questions, or if you're part of the live event, ask questions. Either way, it would be great to hear from you.